do that hand-to-hand combat with all those Black Friday shoppers. How about some holiday hoops from historic Reed Arena on the campus of Texas A&M? The Aggies been making a lot of noise in the early part of this season, off to a 3-1 start, and this afternoon taking on the Privateers of New Orleans. Hi again, everybody. Dave Baker alongside the former Tennessee great Dane Bradshaw. Dane, you knew what kind of difference you could make when you could come into a game and make some shots. They've now got some difference makers here at Texas A&M, and in particular, a young man named Daniel House, who had an incredible debut.
The Aggies had a lot of pieces to their puzzle in place, but this could be the missing piece in Daniel House, who is a difference maker, game changer. He can knock it down from three, as you'll see here, as he did against New Mexico and Puerto Rico, but you can't play in Kennedy's system if you can't defend. He's got that covered. And he's got a swagger and confidence going on with his teammates, and they're getting out in the open floor and running, and he can do the job finishing at the basket. The guy's a complete difference maker, and he's a reason why the rest of the conference is looking over at A&M saying, what is going on with the Aggies? And it's a good thing for them.
They got all their ducks in a row before they submitted his hardship request to become eligible immediately after transferring from Houston. They got that, and they flew him right over to Puerto Rico. He got there in time for the fifth place game, and what an impact he's made, so much so that they weren't planning on starting him until next week. But you see House in the starting lineup along with Jordan Green and Alex Caruso in the backcourt. Jalen Jones is a 6'7 junior and another one of those players that had to be declared eligible by the NCAA. He originally signed with A&M in 2012, Tony Trocia Morelos. There you see Broyles, Brown, Nate Fry, Kevin Hill, and Terrence Sion, and it's Brown, the 6'2 senior, who's the transfer from SMU, who has made such a big impact for Mark Schlesinger and the Privateers of New Orleans. Lee Cassell, our lead official, along with C.J. Washington and Rick Hartzell. A&M in the home white, New Orleans in the road blue. And we are playing in the SEC. A&M suffered that one loss over in Puerto Rico to Dayton. That's the only L in four games. Boy, just look how athletic A&M is early on. The one thing they have not been able to do is really finish plays, and that's something the staff has put a lot of emphasis on.
Well, this is a second chance opportunity for the Aggies. That's the one thing Coach Schlesinger was concerned about coming in. One of many things, but that was a big one. Could they keep the Aggies off the glass?
Make the extra pass. Still can't get a basket out of it. Offensively, our first look at the Privateers. Look at House. Known for his offense, and you talked about him being a difference maker. He gets the deflection and creates the first turnover.
And that's something, if in Kennedy's system, you're not going to play, you can't defend. And so as good as House is on the offensive end, he knew he had to buy into the defensive philosophy, and getting those deflections are a big key.
Foul on the play is Jones. His hand checked on the way to the basket. Terrence Sion whistled for the foul. It's his first. Right back they go to Jones, who can't finish. And Sion picked up the foul again, so he picks up two fouls in the span of about 10 seconds. And Mark Schlesinger ready to go to his bench already.
Jalen Jones has got to finish that. I know he got fouled, but you can't get any closer than that. That's what my old coach Bruce Pearl used to tell us when we miss layups. I can't get you any closer. At some point, it's your job to put the ball in the hole.
Checking in to the New Orleans lineup. There you see Sion headed to the bench. And Travian Thibodeau, 6'8", 220-pound freshman. And they're in the state of Louisiana, checking in. The only man that they've got awfully high hopes for. And we've played about a minute of this one. No field goals, but the Aggies with the early 2-0 lead.
Alex Caruso defending the point guard. He's got great length at that position, something the Aggies have a real advantage on New Orleans.
Go right to Thibodeau. He works on Jones. bounce pass. That shot was challenged. And credit New Orleans. As Tevin Broyles gets the offensive rebound.
A great defensive effort by the Aggies. New Orleans was never even able to get inside the three-point line there. That's exactly what you want to do, but you have to be able to finish the play defensively. So now we've seen early on the Aggies unable to finish on the offensive end, but there's also a finishing aspect to the defensive side as well.
Jones was called for the foul. It's his first. Broyles, a 75% free throw shooter, misses the first. Of course, the early start here in College Station. Good crowd on hand. Hoping to take advantage of the folks who were here for the football game last night as the Aggies came up short against LSU. And off the turnover. And who was that? It was Caruso who got back on defense and drew the offensive foul.
That's Alex Caruso for you. Typically takes care of the ball better, but a guy that is accountable, he's going to make a turnover here, something he's got to do a better job of. But when he gets back on defense, he's going to make up for it. He's not going to sulk his head. He's a tough kid, gets his nose in there, draws a foul, gets it right back. Great play.
Still looking for our first field goal of the game, 2 minutes in. Boy, and that's a tough catch inside and an even better finish by the freshman, Tony Trocia Morelos.
Important for a young guy like Morelos to get started early, get an easy one in there. He missed a bunny early on, but now that should give him some confidence.
And they say that Royals stepped on the sideline. Another turnover against the Privateers.
Watch this post up and seal. You can't seal your guy better than that. That's what we call a duck in. Jordan Green hits Morelos. Morelos, he's been trained and practiced. Well coached there and got the bunny as a result.
You see Christavius Gill, number 5. 5'8 sophomore from Alexandria, Louisiana, who just checked into the game after the third turnover of the afternoon for New Orleans.
Kevin Hill, who you just saw grab that board for New Orleans, he's going to have a heck of a night on the glass. Keep these Aggies to one shot on the offensive end.
Boy, got that rebound and made a pretty move and just couldn't finish. Russo able to thread that pass in there.
That's a heck of a pass by Caruso.
It is, but then where did Jones have to go with it?
Exactly. He had to catch it down low there, and that was one of the things we talked about, Billy Kennedy. Look at him thread the needle a little bit too late there, but talking to Billy Kennedy, he said Caruso sees the play before anybody else, and sometimes that can be a negative. He's so far ahead of everybody that the other players aren't on his same level from a court vision and basketball IQ standpoint.
Good hedge out by the Aggies. But still, they get it over to Kevin Hill. And Hill with the first field goal of the afternoon as Caruso, you talked about how he's able to thread the needle, but that's the one thing. He has shown an ability to get out of control every now and then. He tries to make something happen at the other end and commits the charge.
He's such a smart, heady player and so ferocious and plays with such intensity. Sometimes that gets the best of him right there. It's especially after a make, it's hard to get anything in transition when the other team is already set. That's a play you can make after a steal or a defensive rebound, but in that case, you want to set it up in half court, run your offense.
Line in there like that, it reminded me a lot of a kid with floppy hair who played for Tennessee not too long ago. Colton Weisbrod, 6'5", 215-pound freshman from Nederland, Texas, wearing number 13. Has just checked in. And the Aggies only lead by one. SEC Network Basketball is brought to you by State Farm. For auto, home, life, and banking, get to a better state. Boy, we have dealt with a lot of tough weather or around the United States here on this Thanksgiving weekend, but it is absolutely gorgeous here in College Station. It's supposed to be in the 70s over the weekend. Here inside Reed Arena, Texas A&M holding the early one-point lead over New Orleans, and Billy Kennedy, 17-3 at home last season. You see this the third season at Texas A&M, and a guy that really seems to have things in place now, Dane, and at least early on with all this talent, the one thing they've not been able to find just yet is that offensive consistency, and that's been the case today.
And that's exactly where they want Daniel House to contribute, both on the defensive end, but where they really needed the boost was offensively. That time you see Caruso, who can really be a factor for him as well.
And it was House who got the block on the defensive end, and there may not be anybody in the SEC better at the long pass than Caruso.
I think Caruso's the best passer in the SEC. When I asked Billy Kennedy, he started laughing and said, I think he's one of the best in the country. You saw it right there with the great kick ahead. And Jordan Green looking like his cousin, Gerald Green, who's been in NBA dunk contests in the past.
Boy, how about that pass inside? My goodness. Weisbrod got it to go, but it was Nate Fry with a beauty of an assist.
Aggie fans on their heels. I can hear them behind us waiting for Daniel House to get his first bucket so they can give him a big ovation and welcome him to Aggie country. Look how far New Orleans is having to run their offense. That's exactly what A&M wants to do, push them out far away from the basket.
Weisbrod with a nice look out top, and now the shot clock under 10 for the first time today. Both teams getting some good looks. Just having trouble getting them to go. Jones held on to it, and he'll go to the line.
In the landscape of today's college basketball, it's almost like a free agency with so many transfers out there. Jalen Jones, one of them, from SMU, who's been a big boost for A&M. I think he could be a real key for the Aggies. Before Daniel House came on in Puerto Rico, they were really trying to run their offense through Jones, it felt like. And I think he can do that, but I think he's probably at his best, not necessarily being a role player, but maybe a second option or a complement to somebody like House and Caruso. And he provides a lot of mismatches, both offensively and defensively. And one of the reasons a lot of people think the Aggies have a good chance to compete and contend in the SEC this year.
Jones knocks him down. Antoine Space checks into the lineup. One person we've not seen yet is Courtney Robertson, who has a long, long history here. Aggie basketball program. He just checked in, number 14. Did not start. See the big, heavy brace on his left knee. Battled a variety of illness and injury. On 114 games now he's played as an A&M Fighting Aggie.
They've needed them in every single one of those. Big guy down low that gets them a lot of boards and gives them some power and presence in the paint.
Jordan Green called for the foul. It's his first. That'll put Tevin Broyles. Sunday on SEC ESPN Network, senior David Laurie leads the Gaels into Fayetteville to take on junior Michael Qualls and the Razorbacks. Iona takes on number 25 Arkansas Sunday at 3:30 on SEC ESPN Network, and watch ESPN app.
And who would have thought the Razorbacks by the end of this week might be the team in the top 25 besides Kentucky and not Florida. Florida's had a couple tough losses, some injuries, but the Razorbacks have done their part so far this season.
Michael Qualls, Mr. at walk on air. Might have thought that. Well, House has gotten some good looks and hadn't gotten any of them to go. Space with the offensive rebound. And he was fouled. Jordan Green heads to the A&M bench. Alex Robinson 6'1", 174. A high school freshman from Arlington, Texas. Checks into the lineup. There he is with a basketball.
Thought Alex Robinson had some great minutes and great play for this team out in Puerto Rico. Didn't look like a freshman at all.
Boy, and how about that? Speaking of good-looking freshmen, how about Peyton Allen? 6'2", 202-pounder from Springfield, Illinois, who knocks down his first shot.
He was a 2,000-point scorer in high school. He can flat fill it up and shoot the ball. Shot was a little off in Puerto Rico. Good to see him get the cover off it.
Tough turnaround. Kevin Hill draws the foul.
I think the pace of this game, the way things are going, is to New Orleans' advantage right now. Even though they're down five, they're getting to the free throw line a lot, keeping it slow, making it tough on A&M to get into transition. If New Orleans could take care of the ball a little bit better, I think they'd be in good shape.
There you see New Orleans head coach Mark Schlesinger in his third year in the program.
Got himself a nice new contract extension.
He did. Really likes what they're doing with the program down there. Slow and steady. He believes there's a huge upside. And a nice kick out. And there's Allen again. And what we're seeing now is probably the biggest difference between this A&M team and others that Billy Kennedy has had. If the guy who's the bell cow wasn't hitting before, you know where else you could go. He's got a lot of places he can go now.
There's a freshman mistake by Robinson, but prior to that, he made a heck of a play. Penetrate pitch to have a freshman point guard get into the knife of the defense, make the right read, kick it to a freshman shooter in Peyton Allen. That's a great sign for A&M. But on the other end, you got to be more disciplined and not foul a three-point shooter.
There you see Billy Kennedy.
Talked to Coach Kennedy. This is definitely the most depth they've had since he's been here. But he said chemistry-wise, this is the best group of guys and guys that are just locked in together. Nobody cares who gets the credit. Very unselfish. When you bring in a guy like Daniel House, that's one of the questions I had was, is that going to be a negative chemistry-wise? Would there be any jealousy of his new role? And he said absolutely not. Everybody loves Daniel House, and he's a member of their family.
Gill got one of two. Ninth free throw taken in the early going by New Orleans. They're 6 of 9 from the line. They trail the Aggies by just 4. And House still can't get it going.
New Orleans went to a zone that possession. They're going to stay in it. One of the dangers of a zone is trying to make sure you get your box out reads.
Allen may have gotten a little too frisky with that one. After making his first two. I think with each offensive possession, New Orleans getting a little more confidence. Privateers looking for another bucket before our next media timeout.
Not penetrating very well, but they're being patient. Patience is better than a turnover or a bad shot.
How about that? Royals with the best move of the day for either team. Makes it a one possession game.
Good help defense there by New Orleans. Made it a tough shot for Daniel House instead of a layup. Great help. Hear Coach Schlesinger saying, bring it out, bring it out. Let's keep bringing it down to the late in the shot clock. Making A&M work a little bit. Make sure we get a good shot. We'll bring a high ball screen here. Looks like.
Hello. Tevin Broyles taking a College Station quite nicely, thank you.
If it works, keep going at it. Broyles was successful on the last trip down. Coach Schlesinger said, hey, ISO, let's get him in a small pick and roll and let him go to work.
A lot of people tell you this coaching thing isn't real complicated unless you make it that way. If a guy's hitting, keep getting it to him. And look at this. Oh, my goodness. Daniel House almost jumped completely over top of Gill, but caught him.
Gill's a short guy, but that doesn't mean he's easy to jump over.
No, sir. But I'll tell you who's got it going now. How about Tevin Broyles?
Broyles putting the team on his back. New Orleans hanging in there. Look at Broyles coming back again with a nice floater, teardrop, bucket, good.
College Station, and the Aggies have not gotten going yet. New Orleans has come back to tie up A&M. As we've got just over 10 minutes to play in the first half. We've talked a lot about the steps and strides that Texas A&M has made this year. And Billy Kennedy just flatly said that they needed to do that after the season they had a year ago. 18-16, they were ninth in the SEC. Jamal Jones decided to transfer after assistant coach Glenn Ciprian left. And the Aggies last year, while 17-3 in this building under Billy Kennedy, were only 1-13 away from home. And that's part of building a program, David Mitchell.
If you look at that, it might give the impression that it's a bleak outlook for the Aggies, but anybody familiar with this team and the changes that have been made knows the outlook is much more brighter for these guys. Rick Stansbury coming on the staff with his experience and great coach, a guy that I played against as he was coaching the Mississippi State Bulldogs. I'll tell you what Rick Stansbury does better than anybody, a lot of things, but getting his team ready for the SEC tournament, and that's going to be a critical piece to the Aggies' future.
Now, that's very kind of you, but the thing that Rick Stansbury does is he goes and gets players.
That's right, which allows them to do well in those
tournaments.
And
Billy Kennedy will tell you you're better coach when you got better players.
That's right, and he's not done recruiting. He's already had a great impact with these guys, and he's done a phenomenal job. But think about it, if you're Billy Kennedy, how great is it to have somebody who's coached in this league sitting on the bench right next to you? Rick Stansbury just done a fabulous job. Fun catching up with him. I know he's excited to be back in this league as well.
22 years down at Mississippi State as an assistant or a head coach. He started out in the Ohio Valley Conference as an assistant under Lake Kelly at Austin Peay, and then was Richard Williams' assistant at Mississippi State and had so many great years there. I think it says a lot about Billy Kennedy as well that he's secure enough with himself as a coach and a person to bring somebody on the bench who's got that kind of experience.
That's a great point. As things get turned around with the Aggies, Rick Stansbury's going to get a lot of credit, and Billy Kennedy's okay with that. He's okay with deflecting that attention. And as we see now, Alex Caruso making smarter decisions with the basketball, taking what the defense gives him, gets him to the lane for the finish.
Caruso's layup stopped an 8-0 New Orleans run, which gave the Privateers their first lead. And there's the defense and the steal by Robertson.
Hey, big man, bring it up the court yourself. Right when I was about to say give it up to a guard, he kept going and dunked it.
You only said that because you're a guard.
That's right. We want to get the assist. If you're going to get a dunk, we've got to get an assist.
You guys are always the first ones to say give it up and always the first ones to claim you had a clear path to the basket.
There was a clear layup right there. Penetration kills. You get in there and draw so much attention, just like Caruso does to Allen there. If you can draw an extra defender, that's going to get your man wide open. Peyton Allen on fire to start this game.
Peyton Allen 3 of 4 from the field. He's now 2 of 3 from outside the stripe. Two blocks on the possession. And the Aggies with a chance to push tempo again.
You got Robertson leading the break. You got Peyton Allen blocking shots. I don't know what's going on here.
And how about that look inside? When you start hitting from outside the arc, that's the kind of thing that'll open up. And Antoine Space, the beneficiary. But there's no question that Peyton Allen has made things go here since that last time out for the Aggies.
Peyton Allen coming off the screen. He slips the screen. Antoine Space with a nice finish. But that doesn't happen if they don't respect the shot of Allen so much. Great no-look feed. Things are going well for the Aggies, and it's because of Peyton Allen.
Saturday, the SEC ESPN Network brings you a college football doubleheader. First at noon, one of college football's most storied rivalries. Number 9, Georgia, relying on that clean, old-fashioned 8 as they take on number 16, Georgia Tech at noon. Then Tennessee's push for a postseason bowl game continues against SEC East foe Vanderbilt at 4. Two great football matchups Saturday, the SEC, ESPN Network, and watch ESPN.
If I'm Coach Schlesinger, get a timeout. It's a good timeout, even though the media timeout's coming up. But just get your team to calm down and do what has been working for you. Take the shot clock down. Look for this to be a long possession and see if they can't get something towards the end.
9-2 is the Texas A&M run. And before that timeout, New Orleans was able to find the seam. They were able to make shots. And ever since they've come back from that timeout, Mark Schlesinger's team has found that every pass has been challenged. The Aggies have controlled the boards.
Can't ask for a better look. Neither, not on that one either.
You can't ask.
To find a way to finish.
You can't ask for better ball security, though, as Antoine Space lost it twice.
Nate Fry continuing to battle. Misses the wide open three, misses the layup, but he doesn't give up. He's going to take it to timeout. Feisty young fella, Nate Fry.
Turned things around since our last timeout, putting together a 9-2 run. Dane Bradshaw, when they penetrate, good things happen.
Penetration kills. If the defense doesn't stop, you take it to the basket. Look here, if the defense does stop, you kick it out to your wide open teammate. And then on this next possession, New Orleans was confused. Are we in man? Are we in zone? Slip the screen, Antoine Space. And that all was drawn up by Peyton Allen's penetration and his threat as a shooter.
And Dane, you can sense it on the court when a team is kind of maybe reeling a little bit or not figuring out what you're doing. And when you've got the ball in your hands, and I know you did this, that's when you want to push the tempo even a little more.
It is. When you have playmakers, guys that, like a Caruso, when the ball is in their hands, they're usually looking to attack, but they're also looking to pass first. As a teammate, you can't ask for anything better than a pass-first guy. So move without the basketball. Anticipate getting open to get that ball and knock it down.
Nate Fry, who took it away from House a couple of different times after he got two offensive rebounds. And Privateers would be in a world of hurt right now were it not for the free throw line. Despite that miss, 9 of 13 is New Orleans from the line, and they get another offensive rebound.
I mean, you think about before we went to break, Nate Fry missed a three, stole the outlet pass, then got the rebound, then gets his own. This is about their fifth shot within this one possession.
They have done a lot of good things with not a lot to show for it in this one trip. And that's great defense. That was Dylan Johns, another one of those players that recently got eligible. 6'11", 231 from Ipswich, England.
There's that penetrate pitch again.
Johns and Space couldn't keep it in. Alan Caruso in there, along with Devontae Fitzgerald, 6'7", 209, sophomore from Atlanta. There you see Jalen Jones check back in. I believe he's an important player for this program, not only because of his ability, but because of the success they had in recruiting him out of the Dallas area.
He can switch on all types of screens. He can guard guards. He can guard bigs. He's a multi-purpose player and somebody who's really important for the Aggies.
And Allen threw that one away.
That's a bad read by Peyton Allen. Dylan Johns has just gotten into the game. He's still a little bit of raw. Didn't have good post-up position there. Swing the ball around, make it rotate, let Johns be able to establish himself before trying to make that pass.
You always like that assist-turnover ratio to be 2-1. A&M with 5 turnovers and 5 assists. Nice position inside. But Hill couldn't get it to go, and the Aggies with another chance. Boy, that's a pretty move. Fitzgerald did not finish that. But that's the kind of player and the kind of drive to the basket that has A&M coaches and fans so excited about what could be.
Fitzgerald missed an open three earlier, so he's still getting warmed up, makes a good decision to turn down a contested three, slice the defense. That's a really good job. Young guys, if you're watching at home, that's how you're able to slide against the guy that's trying to draw the charge on you. It's not easy to do. That's a very athletic move to draw the foul and avoid the charge.
Checking back in the A&M lineup, Jordan Green, who replaces Peyton Allen. Allen gets a nice hand from this crowd. 3 of 4 from the field, 8 points for Allen as he leads the Aggies in this first half.
This is the guy New Orleans needs to get going. Kevin Brown, great player for them. He's a transfer also, and somebody who's been great for them in the first two games. Right now, he's been a little bit quiet.
Travel called against the Privateers. It's the 7th turnover of the afternoon for New Orleans, a team that has now missed 6 shots in a row. And despite the fact that A&M has struggled offensively, New Orleans has really not been able to capitalize.
They really haven't. Coach Schlesinger should be pretty pleased with the looks he's gotten, but they're not finishing the open shots, and they're not taking care of the basketball. Neither team really seems to be very sharp or awake this Black Friday.
How about that? That is a pretty high-low play right there.
That's something A&M likes to do a lot. They like to operate and run their offense out of that high post, that elbow. And with bigs that can pass the ball well, you can do that.
Oh, there's what you're talking about. Kevin Brown goes deep. That's the first New Orleans bucket in a while, and they certainly needed it. The Privateers back in that zone defense.
Yeah, with that zone, Jordan Green going to attack it there. A couple ways to beat the zone: off penetration with the dribble or penetration with the pass.
Boy, and you can see the frustration there by Jalen Jones. Averaging about 12 and a half points a game. And again, I was kidding around with Billy Kennedy before. I asked him how close he was to going to the platoon system like Calipari's done. He said, we're not there yet. But this is something he didn't have the luxury of. When guys struggle, you can go to the bench. There's House back in. And not surprisingly, after sitting over there and not being happy with his play as a starter, he knocks down the first bucket he takes coming back in.
Well, it gives guys a breather, gives them a chance to regather themselves, and also makes you accountable. Well, you know if you don't do your job that somebody else on the bench will come in and they will do it, and makes you a better player and better teammate.
Hey, everybody heating up. First Brown and now Tevin Broyles. Back-to-back triples for the Privateers. And a foul is going to be called on Green as he and Brown tried to come down in the same piece of real estate. Brown may have caught an incidental elbow, maybe in the process.
See if this hand hits him in the eye here. Oh,
yes,
yeah,
he did.
Elbow to the nose. Jordan Green looked at him as if he didn't touch him, like he was acting. I don't think he's doing an acting job there. That was a legit blow to the head.
I think that's just something they teach you guys in guard school when you first take it.
You can't make a call without expecting a complaint.
You see Brown, who'd just gotten going, trying to shake it off. The officials can go over and look at the monitor. No need to, in my opinion, there. That's perfectly inadvertent.
You don't feel good about the blow to Kevin Brown if you're New Orleans, but you do feel good about the position you're in. You're in the bonus. You've earned that throughout this first 15 minutes or so of being aggressive, getting yourself fouled into the foul line. Now you can try to get some cheap, easy baskets and points, but you got to convert.
Brown misses the front end. Boy, a rough couple of trips. Frustrated over getting hit in the nose, then he misses the front end of a bonus, and that's exactly what Mark Schlesinger is talking to him about. He then turns around and commits a foul in the open court, and it's the 7th team foul that'll put the Aggies in the bonus. Johns with a takeaway.
Dylan Johns giving the Aggies some good minutes. Right when he came in, he blocked a shot, and then now he picks up a nice bucket down low. Really soft touch on that right off the glass.
Out of control. And a The charge is going to be called against Tevin Royals.
Great help side defense by Daniel House. And it's exciting to see the bench get excited about a defensive stop. Not a lot of teams buy into it and get as excited about a defensive play as they do offensive. But under Billy Kennedy's direction and his program, these guys are all in for, on the defensive side.
Mark Schlesinger has to go to the bench right away because Broyles, with just over 4 minutes to play in the first half, picked up his third foul. So Brown comes right back in. Got a hand on it and thought he had a turnover. The Privateers have had some trouble, but they battle with the Aggies. They're still battling. SEC Network Basketball is brought to you by Regions Bank, Regions' official bank of the SEC. Boy, so much history and tradition. This is just a really neat place to visit for those of you in the SEC footprint. If you haven't been to College Station yet, you need to find a way to make a visit. It's got a little something for everybody. Texas A&M leads New Orleans by six. And there you see the much talked about Daniel House, the transfer from just up the road in Houston. Got the start today. Courtney Robertson came up with a sore knee. Robertson has played, but House, after that great debut in Puerto Rico, only managed to knock down one field goal today.
What's great about that for Daniel House is that the fact that he hadn't had the shots go in like he wanted, it hadn't affected his defensive intensity. He still made plays, getting steals and drawing charges.
And a hand check is called, and that'll put Jalen Jones at the free throw line. The Aggies have also been able to stretch this out, not surprisingly, because of the big advantage they have inside, a 16-6 advantage in terms of points in the paint. Saturday on the SEC ESPN Network brings you live an alternate presentation of the Iron Bowl. Join Paul Feinbaum and the SEC Network analysts as they break down highlights and discuss the game as it happens. Paul Feinbaum Film Room, Iron Bowl Live, Saturday at 7 on SEC ESPN Network, and watch ESPN. There's not a better game to watch than the Iron Bowl, and I can't think of a better person to watch it with than Feinbaum. Oh, my gosh. Maybe he'll get that guy. He could get that gal from Mulga in there with him. Is it Phyllis from Mulga?
Ratings will be at an all-time high.
Oh, my gosh. I think we've got the last pre-Iron Bowl edition of Feinbaum coming up right after our game. Shot clock at three. And Thibodeau shot it over the basket. That'll technically be a shot clock violation and a good defensive stand by the Aggies.
New Orleans wants to run the clock down and be patient on offense, but if you're going to be patient and take it down the last few seconds, you better be ready to catch the ball and shoot it. Thibodeau just didn't have his hands ready that time.
There you see, as we talked about earlier, and Dane broke it down for you, when they penetrate and pitch, good things happen. Tony Trocia Morelos.
He's got a mismatch down low.
Yes, see, about a foot's worth of mismatch right now.
New Orleans recognizes it with the backside help. Harder to get it in there than people think.
Morelos at 6'10". He was being guarded in there by somebody at 5'8", and that opened things up as they had to double for House from the outside.
As much as Daniel House will help Alex Caruso, the same can be said in reverse. I think House is really going to benefit from having a guy like Caruso, who's just a flat-out playmaker and wants to penetrate and pass first, shoot second.
And so now, here in the final moments of the first half, A&M starting to stretch it out, and Mark Schlesinger senses that, and he takes a timeout.
Good timeout by Coach Schlesinger there. Get your guys rallied. See if you can come up with a defensive stop, because you're in a danger zone right now. If you can go into halftime under 10, I think you'll be in good shape.
Mark Schlesinger, one of those guys, good dude. I mean, just a really good guy to have in coaching. He took over this program when they were still trying to decide if they were going to stay at D1. They did that. Last year, they played a couple of years, actually, as an independent. And then last year, their first year in the Southland, went 13-14. They went 8-10 in conference play. And they've won 73% of their home games. And he says he's got great kids, a great area to recruit from. And the guy does everything. He said, if you have got a group, it doesn't make any difference how big or how small, he'll go talk to them. He talks to neighborhood associations. He talks to Catholic men's groups. He says it is so important to get the community involved in New Orleans. And they love the job he's doing. And he loves the place he's doing it at.
And you get that feel within the first 2 minutes of talking to the guy. You can tell he's just a down-to-earth, fun-loving, but hard-working basketball coach.
Well, he's adapted to New Orleans, being a Hoosier. Billy Kennedy is all New Orleans. Tricia Morelos gets it to go. And I'll have a chance to complete the and one.
Great cross-court recognition. Skip pass from Caruso. Overhead pass, penetrate, and again, kick to the open big man. And that's a situation where New Orleans just isn't tall enough. Trosha Morelos is just taller than you. And does a good job of keeping it high and placing it in the basket, not making it harder than it needs to be.
You mentioned it a couple of times, though, Dane. I mean, you know, House struggled with that shot. He's made defensive plays. He's blocked shots. He got that assist. And as you see, it has extended that run to 9-0.
You read so much into a player's body language. House was as excited to see Morelos get an and-one as if it was himself. He's just a good, unselfish, as we talked about earlier in the show, a final piece to Billy Kennedy's puzzle for this year's team.
As much of a difference as he's made for A&M, that's the difference. And Kevin Brown has made for New Orleans. Trisha Morelos, good looking three-pointer there for the big fella.
Yeah, if you can make it from 2 feet, try it from 25, see what happens. Not a bad stroke for the big man.
If you try it too many times, you'll be reminded that you're supposed to try it from 2 feet.
That's why they got depth over there.
Privateers looking to run some clock. Thibodeau looked like Morelos got a hand on it. Oh, goodness! Where did that come from? He was a ball boy when he was a kid here at A&M. My goodness.
That's what we call sneaky bounce. Don't sleep on him or he'll sneak up on you and put you on a poster. Alex Caruso, there's a reason why they compare him to Manu Ginobili. Just kind of a wiry, crafty guy, but he can get up there and throw it home with the best of them, too.
Did you say sneaky bounce?
Sneaky bounce. Don't get caught slipping on him. He'll dunk on you.
Deep three won't go. Final heave. And Texas A&M, they didn't start so well, but an 11-3 run to end the half. They have stretched it out on the strength of that depth that we have discussed. As 10 of 11 players ready to go today have put in baskets. They've penetrated, they pitch, they've shot it well, and when they have had the opportunity, they have been able to finish in a big way. Texas A&M 40, New Orleans 28. Our halftime activities come your way next. Texas A&M on top of New Orleans, 40-28 at the half. At SEC Basketball Media Day, Sean Farnham and Tony Delk took A&M guards Alex Caruso and Jordan Green out to the sport court to show the importance of teamwork.
Here are two of Texas A&M's finest. When you talk about Jordan Green and Alex Caruso, and Jordan, let me start with you. You've got a point guard that loves to facilitate. How important and how great is that to play with a guy like him?
Yeah, it's pretty great. Very important. You know, he gets you in the right positions. He sets up the offense. You know, make sure you're in the right positions. He's actually a scoring threat too. So when he comes down, guys key on him too. So it carries open shots, and you know he's able to hit you at wherever you are. So you got to be, you have to be aware wherever you are on the court because he's gonna find you.
Alex, bring the ball down the court as a point guard. What exactly are you looking for?
First, I'm trying to locate where the defense is, see and read them, see where they're going, how they're reacting. And then next, I'm looking for my guys streaking down the court, trying to get the ball up the floor.
Can you two guys show us the chemistry that the two of you have developed over the offseason?
Yeah.
And chemistry is a catchword that we always use in college basketball, but the importance in chemistry is not just one person understanding what the other person is. You both have to work together. And how have you guys been able to develop this?
Right. So, I mean, just countless drills doing the same thing, reacting to penetration and being ready and catching and shooting. So say that he's guarding there, say I beat my guy off the dribble, he's got to be able to ready to fill up, react, and be ready to shoot.
All right.
So I come here, and I kick to him, shot, and he makes it.
Boom, just like that. Texas A&M, their offense looks to be on track this season because they've got a player that worked really hard in the offseason to shoot his outside shot. He just proved it, and one of the best facilitators in the SEC.
Thank you, gentlemen. Now, if they could just do a little more of that in the second half, it would make this home crowd even happier. There you see Alex Caruso's numbers, only two turnovers. Got called for a charge. But I'm telling you, we saw his explosiveness at the basket, Dane. When he is making good decisions about not only what he does with the basketball, but who he gets it to and when, this has got the potential to be a dangerous team.
No question. And Alex Caruso is a guy who led the SEC in assists last year on a team that could hardly put the ball in the basket.
Right.
Think about what he'll do now with Daniel House and an improved lineup, Peyton Allen, guys that can knock down some shots. Alex Caruso is a coach on the floor, a great executor, and just a flat-out playmaker.
He had 30 assists coming in the first four games and 170 assists last year. And much like their slow start at the beginning of this game, A&M starts out with something that they certainly didn't want, as Jordan Green not only picks up his third, but he fouls a three-point shooter.
That's the second time the Aggies have fouled a three-point shooter. I'm sure that'll be a point of emphasis tomorrow when they watch the film. Through New Orleans, that's exactly where he wanted to start the second half, was at the foul line. That type of pace and getting those easy points at the charity stripe is what kept them in the game early on.
One, don't
push. A&M at home next week against Sam Houston State. Then next Saturday against Arizona State. Should be a good matchup here at Reed Arena, but still lots of work to do against New Orleans. Pretty spin move. And that's the kind of versatility that has these A&M coaches so excited about Jalen Jones.
That's one of their favorite plays. We call that a little to big screen. A guard setting a screen for a big man. It makes it tough to just switch it for the defense. That's what allowed Jones to get open on the block with great position.
And at the other end of the court, Jones is called for the foul on Terrence Sion.
Didn't see the screen there, but that's how Jones got open, was by Jordan Green, a wing player, setting a screen on a post man.
So two offensive possessions now for New Orleans. And Texas A&M has committed three fouls.
Jordan Green just kind of finding himself in the wrong place at the wrong time on these fouls. He's going to have to spend a lot of time on the bench here in the second half due to foul trouble.
Green in serious foul trouble now as he has picked up his fourth. He is just pacing over there on the sideline, just can't believe he finds himself in this position. Fouls, offensive rebounds. That has led to a lot of balls in the hands of the Privateers here in the opening minutes of the second half. That time it's batted away. And Allen came out of there with it, and they say he was fouled.
It's a promising sign if you're an Aggie fan to see your senior leader and Robertson getting on the floor, but also Peyton Allen, a freshman who understands what it takes in this program. You better get on the floor for a loose ball.
So Jordan Green goes to the bench with his fourth foul, and hustling for that loose ball right there, Tevin Broyles, who's played so well for New Orleans, goes to the bench with his fourth foul. And that comes at the 18:30 mark. Aggies give it away. And Kevin Hill puts it away.
Turnovers are one thing. Turnovers that lead to easy baskets are another. It's like throwing an interception or an interception pick six, but they make up for it there.
Jones has really got an ability to finish in a lot of different ways. And he has been the only consistent player for the Aggies offensively here since the halftime break.
And Alex Caruso, miscommunication on turnover on a weave early on between he and Allen on the last play. But it's great that you can move on to the next play. That's something young guys usually struggle with, and he as a leader is teaching the young guys how to move on to the next play. He immediately gets the ball, continues to attack, and was the one that penetrated and opened up the ground.
Sion has now picked up his fourth.
The Aggies are in a lot better position to handle foul trouble than New Orleans.
Sion called for the illegal screen. And Mark Schlesinger over there talking to Courtney Robertson. And Robertson
probably asking him, hey, you mind getting in foul trouble too?
Started laughing about whatever the other coach said. How about that give and go? Boy, it seems, it seems to this layman that they're just running some sets right now for Jones, and they're working pretty well.
That's why Jones is so versatile. He can catch it on the wing and be a threat himself offensively one-on-one, but in that situation, he came out as a big man to do the pick and roll with House. And what are you going to do? Are you going to not double House? Well, then he's going to kill you. But if you do, he dumps it off to Jones, and the help is too late getting back to him. There's House. Help is too late. You got to rotate sooner than that. Jones does a nice job of not drawing the charge and gets himself to the free throw line for the easy basket.
Boy. And a foul called against House. Billy Kennedy immediately up off the A&M bench. And House, a guy who's got a high motor, saw his reaction. He's handling it better than a lot of guys would have.
I don't think either coach is real happy with the foul situation right now, but you got to adjust as a player. If the refs are calling it close, learn to play defense without using your hands. Don't pick up the cheap ones.
Well, I guess the thing they would ask is, was it called this closely in the first half? Here, we're just now coming up on the 17:30 mark as House comes right back and gets that block.
Where Caruso's at his best, not that time, usually pretty good in transition.
Nice kick. Weisbrod gets the offensive rebound and a stick back.
Coach Schlesinger has to be pleased with the way his team continues to compete and not take the knockout blow. It's been close a couple times for this lead to get extended. They keep fighting back.
Offensive rebound. And the Aggies fouled again. New Orleans has committed five fouls here in the first 3 minutes and 3 seconds of the second half. A&M has been whistled for four.
And Dave, there's no question A&M has a height advantage. But that's not an excuse to not put your butt on somebody, box them out. You can box out a guy that's bigger than you. And that time, New Orleans was trying to jump with them. If you start getting a jumping contest, trying to tip the ball around and get them, New Orleans will never get a rebound. You got to put a body on them.
Alex Robinson checks in for Alex Caruso.
Caruso's had a few turnovers tonight. It was funny talking to Billy Kennedy before the game, and he said, look, we were kind of stressed, wondering, you know, hey, is he not taking care of the ball well enough in Puerto Rico? Then we look down and we say, heck, he was 2-1 assist to turnover ratio. If that's his worst, then we're pretty good.
Travel called against Kevin Hill. 13th turnover of the afternoon against New Orleans. Jalen Jones, 4 points at the break, 7 here in the first 3.5 minutes of the final period.
Hey, hey,
What a kick. What a kick from House across court. And now Allen with another triple. He's also got 11.
That's coaching and execution. House knew before he dribbled that Peyton Allen was going to be sitting in there for the corner.
Allen with a steal. And how about that unselfish play as three guys passed it amongst each other. And Mark Schlesinger takes a timeout as the Aggies have extended the lead to 17.
Peyton Allen doing everything possible for this team. He's got this crowd rowdy and hype. Peyton Allen with the three ball, spotting up. You just got to find him. He'll knock it down.
2:35 as A&M has stretched it out to their biggest lead of the afternoon. Great defense and unselfish play offensively. And that young man may not be the most physically imposing guy. Colton Weisbrod, 6'5", 215, but he's been a bright spot for New Orleans here in the second half. He's 4-4 from the field, 8 points.
He went right at Devontae Fitzgerald, who had just come in the game. You got to be ready to play when you get in.
Fitzgerald got tied up. And the arrow points the way of the Aggies. Fitzgerald trying to get it figured out. And A&M looking to extend a double. SEC Network Basketball is brought to you by State Farm. For auto, home, life, and banking, get to a better state. Beautiful day in College Station. Thanksgiving weekend. Huge crowd on hand last night to see the Aggies battle LSU down to the wire in the football finale. And a good crowd here at Reed Arena this afternoon. They've seen their homestanding Texas A&M squad stretch it out to a 15-point lead over New Orleans. The Aggies look to win for the fourth time in 5 tries. How about that, Dane? That's pretty good right there.
I was just about to highlight that on my stat sheet. 14 assists on 19 made field goals. Better to...
Make that 15 out of 20.
Forget what I was saying. 15 out of 20 is right. Jalen Jones getting up and throwing it down over the defender.
And I think that's one of the biggest telltale marks of a great team. What do you do coming out of those timeouts? Set play, and they executed it flawlessly. And then they get a stop on defense. Fitzgerald got the block, and Jones with back-to-back flushes.
And Billy Kennedy, he doesn't care about those two dunks. He's mad at Robinson for not getting over the screen on the last defensive possession. You know where his priorities lie.
15 now for Jalen Jones. Those A&M bigs, they didn't get a block, but they affected those shots. Fitzgerald. And Mark Schlesinger is going to have to take another timeout. 14-2 is the A&M run, and the lead grows to 22. Time to take a look at today's Good Hands Play. It's brought to you by Allstate. Boy, how about the good hands when you get the ball in position like that, Dame Bradshaw?
Good hands and great play call and execution. Out of the timeout, they drew up a lob to the basket. Really wasn't even that wide open. He just flat out jumped over the defender's head. Not too many guys can do that in the country.
Fitzgerald with the screen. And that led us to today's Good Hands Play, brought to you by Allstate. And it took them a while to get going. But A&M has really gotten into rhythm now and starting to see some other guys. Tavario Miller, 6'7", 222-pound sophomore from Long Island in the Bahamas, wearing number 4. Get the defense right there, checked in for the first time.
And if you think about the way A&M has gotten it going, it's been together. Like we've talked about, Dave, it's not just one guy they're hoping that can get things going and start scoring for them. It's everybody. We've seen the big men pushing up the court. We've seen Peyton Allen. We've seen Fitzgerald, Caruso, Robinson, Jones. Everybody's contributing, and that's what makes A&M so dangerous.
You saw the bump out top by Miller, but it was Fitzgerald off the ball who was called for the foul. How about that play defensively by Trosha Morelos? Fitzgerald hits another three. A&M now 7 of 14 beyond the arc. And Fitzgerald is going to be called for the foul.
Look at the wingspan for Morelos. Not too many guys can have that type of wingspan. Kick it up the court to your point guard. Spot up, Fitzgerald, three is good. Morelos does just as you're taught. Find a guard, Robinson, penetrate, pitch. Fitzgerald, he can really get hot. That's his second in a row. We saw him in Puerto Rico. After he hits a couple, he'll start letting it fly and do a little heat check every now and then. Look for him to let one fly here in a little bit.
Weisbrod has been the guy that's gotten the basket when they've needed it. Good defense by Morelos. A&M has hit all three of its triples here in the second half. Tough catch and a better bucket. And all of a sudden, Texas A&M has gone from a team who couldn't make anything to a club that just can't miss.
And it's amazing how your defense affects your offense. This is all started on the defensive end. A&M is a team that feeds off their defensive stops, the turnovers, getting blocked shots and steals, and that's what leads to great offense for the Aggies.
In all fairness, one thing that has not happened yet is that this group has not played a lot together. As you see that 19-2 run. You know, the guys that came in, yeah, they practiced together, but you didn't know when they would be able to play together. You know, the NCAA rulings and all those things. I mean, from a basketball standpoint, these teams are still taking baby steps with each other.
Absolutely, and with Daniel House coming on, how does that affect the chemistry we talked about? Not only, I'm not so concerned about the chemistry, but playing together. If you were once a starter, now you're playing with the guys coming off the bench. But it seems right now, it doesn't matter who's in there, they're gonna run their system, and they play well together. Great pass, bounce pass off the pick and roll by Alex Robinson.
And you just mentioned something. I mean, House was in there early. He was in there early to start the second half, but he's over there at the table. It's been a while since we've seen him, and they've done this damage without him.
That's the depth that Coach Kennedy's been talking about. It doesn't matter who's in there. It makes guys more accountable. Oh, this place is going to erupt. Peyton Allen has got it going. It's his house tonight.
Allen with 16. During the games I've had an opportunity to do this year, I have seen some runs. But this is as good offensively as Gustavius Gill answers. But what A&M has done offensively after the under 16 timeout here in the second half has been as good from an execution standpoint as I've seen.
If you're just tuning in, it looks like it's been a blowout the entire game, but it's been close in this. New Orleans struggled with foul trouble, something they can't afford. A&M has taken advantage, and they push it in transition. They know how to find the open man. Peyton Allen can stretch that defense, and he's money.
9-42. A&M has stretched it out here in the second half, Dave Baker. Dane Bradshaw, our entire SEC network crew. Privateers have been a game club, but you take a look, and not only is it getting guys out of Texas that we heard about getting guys out of Dallas, but look at the international flag of this A&M team.
they protect their house and keep everybody in state that they can, but they're not afraid to go across the border. They brought in some great talent. That's been a big part of filling this roster and providing that depth.
That's going and getting her done right there now. I mean, England, Colombia.
I'm sure they fight over those recruiting trips. New Orleans going to their zone. Not what Coach Schlesinger likes. He told us before the game, he said, I like playing zone as much as I like going to the dentist's office, but sometimes you just got to do it.
House, who's back in. And the shot clock at 5. Wow. People think when they hear us say stuff like this that it's just like, you know, that whole coach speak. But good shooting and bad shooting is definitely contagious.
No question about it. The lid is off the basket for the Aggies. They've got some easy dunks, but Jones got back-to-back dunks. I feel like it's when the lid really got off the basket and everybody started making shots.
Including that guy, Daniel House.
And at some point, New Orleans, you're getting blown out, but these guys got to refocus and try to not get embarrassed too bad here, because that's something that they can control. Finding a guy like Daniel House in transition is something that they're good enough to do.
Every time House has gone to the bench, we talked about that bench being a great motivator. He has come back in and he's been even better. House 2 of 4 from the field.
When you got a guy as athletic as House who can get it in the get it into the lane and
right.
take it strong to the basket, when he's able to be a threat from the outside is what makes him just a premier player in the conference.
Everybody of the 11 players available today for A&M have scored except for that man with the basketball, Alex Robinson. Under 10 minutes to play and the Aggies in control. Josiah Morelos. And that's the second three that he's taken today. And by the look on Billy Kennedy's face, it might very well be the last one he takes today.
I'm reading more into it. We're up 30. Let's pick and choose our battles at this point.
Yeah, you would. Look at that field goal number. And I think that was that maybe the first three-point miss for A&M this half? And it's the 6'10 guy that missed it.
Well, that's probably been the one poor shot that they've taken. All of it's been off either penetration steals, and we already saw the assist to turnover ratio and how many baskets they've made off assist. And that speaks to this whole team. They play off each other. There's great chemistry, and that's why Coach Kennedy thinks this is the best team he's had since he's been here at Texas A&M.
Now, in terms of getting things going for down the road, this is a move right here for down the road. Because Jordan Green managed to get himself in early foul trouble. They've got this game well in hand. Billy Kennedy wants to get him back in there, help him refine that confidence before they move on into this next week.
Dave, that's such a great point that a lot of people don't realize, but I've been there as a player. You sit there and you say, all right, we're up 30. What good can come from this? Or even if you're on the other end, if you're down 30, New Orleans, there's certain guys on your team who haven't played as well as the others that just need to get a basket or two just to feel a little bit better about themselves going into the locker room at the end of the game, and hopefully that'll spill over to the next game.
Now New Orleans. Changes it to a trap. And that might have been enough just to get A&M out of rhythm a little bit. That's what you try to do. You just change it up and see what might work, and it leads to the basket by Gill.
This opportunity for Coach Schlesinger to try some new things, try these traps, see what might work better in the Southland Conference versus the Southeast Conference.
Gill, the first privateer in double figures. With 13.
Got to find a way to get that ball inside the three-point line. Off the pass or off the dribble. That's not what they want.
House shot it off the side of the backboard. Miller couldn't save it as he went to the ground.
Against the zone, you either want to hit that short corner or find a way to get the ball inside to a big man, make the defense sink a little bit, either on the pass or on the penetration.
14 A&M players, and all have scored. Miller picked up his second. And New Orleans in the bonus. Weisbrod goes out. Kevin Hill back in.
Dave, this is going to be a really interesting team to follow this year. The Aggies are, you know, the preseason rankings were one thing, but that didn't take into account Daniel House being on this roster. And I think Arkansas has been a team that's really lived up to expectations, but LSU, Ole Miss, some of those teams that were fighting for that fourth, fifth spot in the SEC, I think A&M and maybe Georgia are the two teams that might be the most prone to take that spot.
There's no question that there is a concerted effort which began even last year to up the national prominence and the competitive nature of SEC basketball outside of the conference. Mark Whitworth from the league office, working with these coaches and ADs hand in that.
Mark has done a fabulous job, and he's seen it as a result. SEC is winning all their games, but at least they're scheduling harder out of conference. That'll allow the SEC to get more teams in the NCAA tournament.
Robinson missed that one, but it's one of the few times the Aggies have misfired as they're in control. Out against New Orleans here on a Black Friday afternoon edition of SEC basketball. You know, not only has A&M done so well this year, but in terms of the future, they've got a top five recruiting class. ESPN says it's number three in the country. There you see Davis Thomas, DJ Hogue, and Edmund Gilder. And Billy Kennedy says it's something he believes they ought to do every year.
This is Texas A&M. You know, it's a big state, got a lot of really good players. We consider ourselves a premier university in the state, and some other people across the state may not believe that, but that we should get these guys. It's just taking us a while to get them. We've got four Dallas kids who are on board, and to join some Dallas kids that we already have, and so it's a good thing to build, and hopefully we continue to have classes like that in the future.
Boy, this entire staff has just done such a great job. There you see Billy Kennedy, and what he's been able to do, and his coaching staff that he believes is now the best that he's had here.
When you think about next year with these talented freshmen coming in, you also got to look at what does A&M lose. And not to say they don't lose a lot in Jordan Green and Courtney Robertson, but that's not the end of the world. The right. Aggies have done pretty good without those guys tonight. Now, this isn't the toughest competition, but they'll be big shoes to fill, but they got enough to fill.
I saw Amir Abdur-Rahim, who played for Billy at Southeast Louisiana, who's on that staff with he and Kyle Keller, Oklahoma State graduate, longtime coach, and as we mentioned, former Mississippi State coach Rick Stansberry. Mitch Cole, the special assistant, as House takes it right to the rim and a chance to complete the and one.
I'm so impressed with House's defense. A stat that a lot of coaches keep on their sideline is number of deflections. House is one of those guys that will probably lead the Aggies in deflections, which leads to steals, which leads to easy baskets.
Now you say that, and that's a good point, but they have got a lot of those guys that are big. They've got big wingspans and are able to move their feet, so I think it's going to be a real strength for this team.
Look at the court right now. Everybody's got length. Even Alex Robinson right now defending the ball. For a small guy, he's got a big wingspan.
Gill had to kick it back out. And Gill gets the bounce.
It's a good play by New Orleans. You want to keep trying to find some positive things to get out of this game.
Now you break it down into these segments. Try to make something positive happen.
Robinson, that is a pretty step through. And a held ball, and the arrow points the way of New Orleans. Again, you just kind of look up and you're looking for people on the court, Dane, and you know, so many guys with experience here and so many guys that need experience. So it's been a while since we've seen Alex Caruso to let some of these young guys get some experience today that Billy Kennedy knows he's going to have to rely on down the road.
Morelos, Dylan Johns, sometimes I'm not sure freshmen realize how good they have it to be able to come in. We see House taking it to the basket.
That's going to be an intentional foul. I'm not. Okay, that's
good sportsmanship you know, on House's part.
That's a great reaction on the part of House. As Kevin Hill, I think, was genuinely trying to stop the foul, but stop the shot, but that's not the way you go at it.
Nice no-look pass, but that's a little bit too intentional.
He tried to hold him up. I understand, and that's what Mark Schlesinger is over there telling him. It was not a dirty play or a play of frustration, but
credit both the guys for reacting well. Hill tries to pick him up from the ground, and House acts like a first-class guy.
The execution on preventing the layup was not what you would look for.
Back to my earlier point, these freshmen, sometimes they don't realize how good they have it. To have some great guys like Caruso, House, and veterans that can take so much pressure off of them to where they can grow and develop as players without being under a microscope and having so much pressure to perform.
There you see House going to the bench. You saw Caruso.
Dave, I think that last foul scared Billy Kennedy enough to say, all right, let's get Daniel House out of the game.
And that's okay. It's the time of the game when you want to do that.
Avery Johnson Jr., son of one of my idols growing up, Avery Johnson. Same stature, just not left-handed like his dad.
Boy, he's a guy that obviously had a great career. How about that move by Weisbrod? Had a great career. Thought he did a nice job as a coach. Things didn't work out. He's doing this broadcast deal now. And he goes all around the country speaking to groups. And a lot of folks know that Lexington's my home area. And he came and spoke to a bunch of folks there during this last year. I mean, just a tremendous message. And it's great to see his son playing here in the state that he has made his home.
He's one of the good guys in the business, no doubt about it. One of the most respected players at every single level across basketball, Avery Johnson. And his son wants to be a coach as well. And he's learning from one of the best ones in the conference. And, you know, in addition to everything he's already learned at home.
Avery Jr., 5'11", 182. Foul is going to be whistled against Trosha Morelos. Nope, now they say Dylan Johns, 45. And in checking just a minute ago as we've now gone under 5 minutes. Caruso has only played 3 minutes this second half. And he's a veteran guy and he understands all that as Hill taps it in. But that's one of those things. It'll help him physically, and it'll help his team down the road as Billy Kennedy takes a 30-second timeout.
Billy Kennedy, because he has such faith and trust in the maturity of his team, he can leave a star player on the bench for 3 minutes if he knows that's best for the player, best for the team, without having to worry about any prima donnas wondering, man, I'm not getting my touches. My stats are going to go down. There's no pouting, sulking. If anything, Caruso's been right there on the sidelines helping coach him up. Coach him up.
Biggest cheerleader. Sunday on the SEC ESPN Network, senior David Laurie leads the Gales into Fayetteville to take on junior Michael Qualls and the Razorbacks. Iona takes on number 25 and streaking Arkansas. It's Sunday at 3:30 on the SEC ESPN Network. And watch ESPN. And how about the conference in the top 25? See Kentucky, and they have been devastating early on. They'll be tested by Providence on Sunday. And then a big matchup against North Carolina next week. Florida lost to Georgetown in the battle for Atlantis. And Arkansas at 25 with a chance to move up. And I think they continue playing the way that they are now for a period of time, Texas A&M has got the potential to be one of those teams that you're talking about breaking into the top 25.
To do that, you have to beat the teams you're supposed to beat and beat a few of them that you're not supposed to beat. And I think A&M has all the tools to be able to do that.
Shot clock at 10 as Robinson sets the offense. Space. Couldn't hold on.
Antoine Space, a guy that's been somewhat inconsistent for the Aggies, but he was somebody that has started some last year for them, came off the bench, and he's somebody who's going to have to work through and find himself with all the depth that's happened with this roster.
Nice back door, and I believe that was Johns who got that block. What a nice job by Johnson of keeping his head up. I'm telling you. You know, Johns is certainly not as heralded as some of these guys, Dane, but he's a very different kind of player, and I think he really brings a positive to this A&M squad.
He's not afraid to get in there, and he's the guy with his length. If he just stands straight up down there in the paint, he'll bother a lot of big guys in this conference.
Avery Johnson Jr. just put it up on the rim and knows that he got a favorable bounce.
Yeah, he's trying to hold that smile in. Even he has to laugh after that. Nice floater right over the defender.
John's got a hand on another ball. How about that? That right there is the essence. Even though it's late, even though New Orleans is overmatched, that's the essence of what this A&M team is. Unselfish. They've got a lot of different abilities.
Just like you said, shooting and bad shooting is contagious. So is unselfishness and passing the ball. Now all of a sudden, sometimes they're starting to overpass because everybody wants to be the next guy to get the good look and the good dime assist.
Mark Schlesinger takes a timeout just to substitute.
Not just because they're winning and executing, but you just got to love the makeup of this A&M team because of that unselfish trait that they have. I think that starts with Caruso. I think House buying into the system and being a defense first and not afraid to give up the ball.
The Aggies getting some people in and giving them a chance. Boy, there's a happy guy. Alex Caruso's only played 3 minutes of this second half, but he's gotten by on a lot of help from his friends. All kinds of folks in this A&M lineup contributing to what will be a big victory for the Aggies, their fourth in five outings, final 2 minutes and change against New Orleans.
It's a fun time right now when you guys got guys like Kyle Dobbins, Chris Collins checking in for the Aggies, getting a little bit of run that they might not have normally got.
Nice pass inside, and that's Travis Avery, 6'8 junior from Algiers, Louisiana. He's got it to go. Last time these two teams met was back in 1994 in the NIT. And New Orleans won that game 79-73. Not so today. He's led by as many as 31. And Space is called for the travel.
Turn the ball over there, but that's been a big improvement from Puerto Rico to now, from the Puerto Rico tournament to today for the Aggies, is taking care of the basketball. Even early on in this game, they had five turnovers.
But I want you to think about this. You guys that are involved in playing and coaching, you guys want to control and monopolize every period of time. And so then if you're Billy Kennedy, you find out you get three guys eligible, and you bring them over on a plane to Puerto Rico after you're already there. So in light of that, to be so far out of their comfort level, things have gone awfully well.
They certainly have, and I tell you, put yourself in their position. You're over there in a tournament. at Puerto Rico, and you get the news that your star player is now eligible. You pick up the phone, you call the travel department, compliance, your AD, whoever, and say, you get Daniel House here as fast as you can. I don't care what the flight costs.
Well, they had that plane ready to go. And the way that those guys have played, you see why. See Daniel House, 14 points, 2 assists, a couple of rebounds. And a block is going to be called.
Dylan Johns, one of those guys with his height. You don't need to be taking a charge with your hands down. Take the charge with the hands up.
Weeknights at 7 on the SEC Network. Join host Dari Noka, network analyst, discussing all the SEC news of the day. It's on SEC Now. Tonight, do their final breakdowns of Rivalry Week. The Iron Bowl, the Egg Bowl, et al. Tomorrow. And of course, they'll be wrapping up a big weekend of holiday hoops as well. Johnson had that one thrown back at him.
Last possession for the Aggies here, it looks like, and see if they can't get Chris Collins and Kyle Dobbins on the stat sheet. This is usually that time of the game where the coach might draw up something special.
They might be able to get them the ball, but they're going to have to cooperate themselves. Space, and now Johnson to set the play.
There it is for Dobbins. You got your chance.
New Orleans. You see its record fall to 2-1. And despite this result, things still look bright for Mark Schlesinger's program.
And Coach Schlesinger, you schedule these games knowing that this could be the outcome, but you know that it could be a growing pain and something positive. You know, at the end of the season, they're not going to look back and say, man, I wish we never got blown out by 23 to Texas A&M. Certainly didn't want that loss, but they'll look back and say, hey, that was an opportunity for us to play on the road at a big school against a great team, and that enabled us to finish higher in the Southland Conference than maybe they would have.
Texas A&M puts it away in the second half, and they run their record to 4-1. The Aggies roll over the Privateers 87-65. We're back to wrap things up in College Station right after this.